and a member of Judicial Academy, National Judicial Academy, Bhopal. I also welcome all other participating members, including my faculty members, students from different law colleges, advocates, judges, and other participants. Today's topic about the victim is of very important nature. We know very well that we are following this criminal justice system borrowed from your Britishers. There is an adversarial system. Adversarial system, most of the right, the accused right to be silent, and his every right to question the things which are being registered or accused against him, and he should be proved beyond reasonable doubt, and there should not be any opportunity to question the evidence, all those things. As we know, though many accused may be released, but one innocent person should not be punished. There's a general principle we follow during this our criminal justice system. Because of various advantages toward the victim, the accused, and state government is filing case in order to control, in order to regulate, in order to minimize or eradicate such kind of events or accidents or incident in future. At the end of the day, if proved, accused will be kept behind bars, or sometimes he may be charged with some penalties. At the end of the day, the real sufferer is a victim. This victim is not going to have any kind of benefit, but he is going to have some tax with him. Suppose the victim is a incident of rape or a result of the rape. Society always sees that particular girl or lady with a different kinds of thing. A label will be given to her. A tag will be coming with her. Though she is victim, suffered already because of the heinous act of some men. However, the tag of that particular person will be continuing. Nobody will be seeing in a different kinds of. Some people may show sympathy. Some feminist association will come and argue for them. Some committees will come and argue for punishment of that particular accused. However, whatever the tag that has been given to the victim will continue throughout her life, and she'll be suffering. At the end of the day, neither she nor her dependents or her relatives or her parents will have any kind of benefit for that particular. Under these circumstances, what kind of aesthetics this victim will be having in the present criminal justice is a very big argument, very big discussion going on everywhere. If you see the history of the study of the victim, we call it victimology. The victimology or other related issues are beginning from England. For the first time in 1950, one of the British magistrate argued for the sake of giving the protection or some kind of compensation or some kind of in return to save that particular victim from that particular brutal accident or brutal incident. Thereafter, the arguments grown a lot. Even during 1960s, there is a lot of agitations come, or schools of thoughts have come to protect or in support of the victims to be protected. Thereafter, in 1985, UN has created a declaration about the protection of the women and these victims. That is a justice for victim as a beginning. Thereafter, the things further moved. If you see our history of the criminal justice, later on, the Supreme Court has given a judgment in 1983 against, in the case of Rudal Shah versus State of Bihar. For the first time, 35,000 rupees has been paid as a compensation to the victims. This is the beginning of victim compensation arguments in our country, which has triggered further more arguments. Then the CPC, Criminal Procedure Code, has been amended, and Section 357A is added. arguments further increased to bring the life of that particular person under Article 21 of the Constitution, where there is an argument that victim is having a right to live dignifiedly. No person can question her about the whatever the incident or offense that happened against her. Later, again, the directive principles of the state policy were added, which are already argued or added value, asked for the compensation. Legal service authority is given an opportunity or a responsibility wherever there is a question of victim compensation to verify the loss suffered by him. Now, there is new concept is growing about the victims. There is a ethical victim or ideal victim. What do you mean by ideal victim? What do you mean by ethical victim? If there is something happens against that victim without any provocation or without any kind of triggering from our side, though all precautions taken, that particular person is known as a now ideal victim or ethical victim. What are the name? Each country is giving one different kind of name to that particular victim. So this victim has a right. Many countries have brought schemes in protecting the victims. When a victim has already suffered loss financially or the injuries or for the treatment of the bodily injuries or otherwise, this victim has to be paid some compensation. This argument has grown in length and breadth of the globe. Now, even our India also, some 12 to 15 states have enacted or started this victim compensation schemes and started giving the compensation to a real victim who suffers really about that particular part. And the responsibility is going to, again, legal service authority. More particularly during this COVID-19 lockdown pandemic, it is observed many people are making the comments that because of the pandemic, people are staying in their houses. The crime rate is increasing in the houses, more particularly about the domestic violences or against the crimes of the women. And some people are acting for different purposes. As a result, the victims are suffering much more during this pandemic, COVID-19. Under these circumstances, when courts are not working properly, courts are working online only, unless it is urgent and emergencies, extreme emergencies, the case are not going. Police people are already busy with the protection of the society against the COVID or intruder of that particular physical distancing part. So under these specialized circumstances, how a victim has to be protected? What kind of protection measures we have to take? We are having learned panelists with us, well experienced panelists with us. They'll be discussing many more things upon this point. So in fact, I should not talk much because if it is a place and it is time for our speakers to talk, we welcome the speakers to come and discuss on various points of this panel. I request Honorable Justice Veda Prakash Garu and Professor S.P. Srivatsava Garu to discuss important issues on the victim compensation and also the assist of the victim, or we can call this a ideal victim or other new concepts which are being developed nowadays. Thank you, Asta, for giving the opportunities. I welcome all of you again. I will request Asta to proceed further.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to welcome Honorable Mr. Justice Shri Ved Prakash Sharma, sir, the chairman of the Madhya Pradesh Law Commission. He is a former judge of the High Court of Madhya Pradesh and has served at several critical positions in the Madhya Pradesh judiciary. His work as the chairperson of the Madhya Pradesh Law Commission has won him accolades. He has been, in a short period of time, been able to identify outdated state laws for amendment and repeal, a task of almost impossible proportions. He is known for his academic inclination and sharp reasoning. We are honored to have you here, sir.
Yes. Could I start?
Yes, sir. Sir, please.
Thank you. There is resonance in the mic. Every voice is coming back.
So we are able to hear you clearly.
Clearly.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I request you to please reshare your PPT.
Okay, very good afternoon to all of you. Dr. A.V. Narasimha Rao, Director, ECFI Law School, Hyderabad. Esteemed members of the faculty, dear students, in this phase of global corona pandemic, we are connected through technology, and indeed it is a matter of proud privilege for me to have this wonderful opportunity to share my views on an issue which is of most important nature in the existing circumstances, particularly looking to the health and shape of our criminal justice system. I greet all the participants and would like to convey my deep appreciation to the organizers for the choice of the topic, which is very intimately related with what is happening in the criminal justice system. I would like to begin with a statement made by Justice Frank Shooter in the famous case of Jensen versus Baker. I quote, "Law should not sit limply while those who defy it go free and those who seek its protection lose hope." Obviously, it is the victim who seeks the protection. It is the victim who knocks the doors of criminal justice system, complains that some injury has been caused to him, and justice should be done to him. Now, PPT is not yours, maybe that. Yeah. Now, what is the position of the victim in the criminal justice system, and what is the condition of the criminal justice system. These two things can be understood by two statements. One is by Justice Y.K. Sabharwal, former Chief Justice of India, who said almost 10 years back that justice delivery mechanism appears to be on the verge of collapse due to diverse reasons. The most disturbing feature of the criminal justice system is that the crime rate is gradually increasing while the conviction rate is not much encouraging. The question arises, why and what to do? Now, here comes the issue as to where the victim stands in the criminal justice system. As Dr. A.V. Narasimha Rao has pointed out, we have inherited the system from Britishers. This is a system which is primarily focuses on finding of guilt or innocence of the accused. Secondly, it is concerned with the conviction or acquittal. The position of victim is not more than a witness who has to appear before the court when he is summoned. The victim having no active participation in the adjudicatory process is by and large a forgotten entity. Even when called as a witness, he is subjected to long delays, adjournment, and humiliation, which can well be said to be secondary victimization, meaning thereby that one who has come to seek justice becomes the victim of criminal justice system. In this regard, we can have reference to a notification issued by the Government of India in November 2000, constituting Justice Malimath Committee. The frank admission which we find in this notification is, I quote, "People by and large have lost confidence in the criminal justice system. Victims feel ignored and are crying for attention and justice." Now, when we talked about the excesses of victim in criminal justice system, then certain issues arise for us. Firstly, what is the definition of victim? What a victim expects from the criminal justice system? What is the victimology, its meaning and relevance, historical development and global perspective, Indian perspective, and the way ahead? So, it was in 2008, for the first time, when the definition of victim was inserted in the Code of Criminal Procedure by the Amending Act of 2008. Meaning thereby, prior to 2008, there was no definition of victim. There was no focus of the law on the victim. Now, as per Section 2(1) inserted by Amending Act of 2008, the Code of Criminal Procedure, victim means a person who had suffered any loss or injury caused by reason of act or omission for which the accused person has been charged, and the expression includes his or her guardian or legal heir. A more comprehensive definition is found in the United Nations Declaration of Basis of Justice for Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power. It says, victim means natural person who individually or collectively have suffered, including physical, mental injury, emotional suffering, or economic loss, or violations of fundamental rights. In relation to victimization, identified under the scope and also includes their appropriate immediate family or dependents of the direct victim and persons who have suffered in intervening to assist victims in distress to prevent victimization. Now, this definition further gives stress on the basic human rights or violation of those fundamental rights by the system or by any person. The question arises here that ultimately, as a victim, what we expect from the system. Now, five broad aspects in this regard, which has been identified, are firstly, respectful and dignified training, which is critically lacking. We'll come to that later on when we talk about the police, which is the first place of contact for a victim, even for the accused. And second is protection from intimidation and retaliation from the accused during investigation as well as trial. Because this process of intimidation and retaliation starts forthwith when the victim is trying to access the criminal justice system. The third aspect happens to be support, including long-term physical and psychological assistance and practical assistance. Then comes the issue of access to justice to ensure that victims are aware of their rights and are able to participate in proceedings. What is the reality? The reality is that victim comes to know about the trial only when he receives the summons as a witness. I remember a case in which I was the person who lost the first information report. Of course, it was in an official capacity. It was a case of false personification before the court. I had to lose a report. Almost 15 years, I was summoned by the court. That was the first summon. And by that time, I have completely forgotten exactly what happened, what transpired in the court. I have a vague idea that there was a case of personification. Now, just consider the situation of a victim who is illiterate, who is poor, comes from the rural background, who doesn't know the basics of the law, how he can understand things. Now, here comes victimology, which seeks to answer all the issues, all the questions relating to the welfare of the victim in the criminal justice system. Now, when we go to expression victimology, it may be interesting to remember that this expression was coined for the first time in 1947 by a French lawyer, Benjamin Mendelsohn. And he just started working on the victimology. His primary focus was on the interrelationship between the victim and the accused. But later on, the things improved. So the two dimensions of victimology are, firstly, the relationship between the offender and the victim, which deals with the process of victimization. And secondly, the interaction between criminal justice system and the victim, which is of particular interest for us. So, if we just the time when criminal justice system formally came into shape, then it was the victim who will pray, who will request that I have been wrong, I seek justice. Almost some 1700 years BC, in Hammurabi's code, we find section of 282 laws. And one of the edicts says, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. It is inscribed on the stone, which have been preserved. Now, since then, the criminal justice system has progressed a lot. Somehow, the entire focus went to the accused. There should be no violation of his rights. The trial should be a fair trial for the accused. That he should be appraised of each and everything at all the stages of the trial. But somehow, the victim was forgotten. And this was particularly for the reason that the concept of society at large as the victim has replaced the real victim. And the criminal justice system with state dominance is focused on the investigation and adjudication of the crime. There is no particular issue with regard to compensation to the victim, rehabilitation of the victim, reparation to the victim. All these things remained forgotten for a long period. So, the de facto sufferer of the crime became a person who has no place. Now, this thing was highlighted in the report of Justice Malimath Committee rendered in 2003. The report says people by and large have lost confidence in the criminal justice system. Victims feel ignored and are crying for justice for attention. Criminal justice administration will assume a new direction towards better and quicker justice once the rights of victims are recognized by law and restitution for loss of life, limb, and property are provided for in the system. This was observed almost 17 years back, and we know till date, there is nothing very tangible law has come into existence, almost like the laws we have in the United States of America or England or Australia. Now, here we can have a peek into the historical landmarks. We just give us a fair indication how the entire science of victimology has developed. In 1973, first international conference on victimology was held under the auspices of United Nations Organization in Jerusalem, Israel. Almost 6 years after, in 1979, World Society of Victimology was founded in Münster, Germany. In 1985, United Nations unanimously adopted the Declaration of Basic Principles of Justice, Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power, 1985. Which is still considered as Magna Carta of victims' rights. Now the things have troubled a lot since 1981. In United States of America, National Crime Victims' Rights Week is observed every year in April to highlight the needs of crime victims. This year, it was held from 19th to 25th April with the theme, Seek Justice, Ensure Victims' Rights, Inspire. Likewise, since 1990, every year, 22nd February is observed as European Day for Victims of Crime to recognize the plight of victims everywhere and to give voice to their needs. Now this Magna Carta of Victims' Rights of 1985, what it provides? It says that the victim should be treated with compassion, respect and dignity. Should be provided with access to the mechanisms, meaning thereby the criminal justice system, to be informed of their rights, to be informed of their role and scope, timing and progress of the proceedings, and of the disposition of their case. Then, to be provided with proper assistance throughout the legal process, to have their privacy protected and ensure their safety, to be considered for receipt of restitution, and to be informed about receiving compensation. Now, as regards India, the picture appears to be quite dismal. Almost 41 years back, Justice V.R. Krishnaiyer, in his typical style, observed in the case of Ratan Singh versus the state of Punjab, 1979, I quote, victim reparation is still the vanishing point of our criminal law. That is the point where the criminal law vanishes. Then, in the Malimat Committee report, it was expressed that justice to victims is one of the inseparable imperatives of the criminal justice system in India. It pleaded for a holistic justice to victims of crime by allowing them, as a matter of right, participation in criminal proceedings as well as to seek compensation for loss or injury. Few may be aware that in India, in 1992, the Indian Society of Victimology was founded to discuss the problems of victims and to disseminate knowledge of their plight. It is said to be located in the University of Madras. We don't know what is its status now. Of course, one major contribution of Indian Society of Victimology has been to draft a Victim Assistance Bill 1996, with the support of the National Law School of India, University of Bangalore, and the National Human Rights Commission under the chairmanship of Justice V. R. Krishna Iyer. But then, the Victim Assistance Bill has yet to see the light of the law in the form of a formal legislation. Now, ultimately, from where the problem of the victim starts, after commission of the offense, he approaches the police station. Many a times, middlemen are there. Then, what he reports is never recorded. I have my own experience. When I was a student of law, my bicycle was stolen. It was sometimes in 1978 from in front of the main gate of the hospital. My father was ill, he was in the hospital. So I instantly went to the police station. Being a law student, I have a little confidence. And I requested the officer in charge that please record the report to see what was the answer. They said, just bring the receipt of the cycle, which was purchased some 3 to 4 years back. Who will just take in the pocket the receipt of the cycle, just apprehending that it will be stolen? So I went home, tried to find out the receipt, could not be traced. The matter ended in that, of course, we will write a police station diary information that it has been lost, not it has been stolen. I had no other support, but then I could experience that what happens in the police station to a person studying law and in a capital town of Lucknow. Then you see, when a person says that a robbery has been committed, they will say, no, it was not robbery, it was theft. If they say it was dacoity, then they will say it is robbery. So the things go that way, and exactly what happens, cognizable cases are many a times made non-cognizable to suppress the crime data and vice versa. So the things are not very comfortable at the police station. The victim finds another serious problem. The Supreme Court of India has an occasion to make an observation in this regard. In the case of Delhi Domestic Working Women's Forum versus Union of India, 1995, the Supreme Court observed, we will only point out the defects of the existing system. Firstly, complainants are handled roughly and are not given such attention as is warranted. The victims, more often than not, are humiliated by the police. This is something, an observation of the Supreme Court, which we cannot just criticize. It speaks volumes about what is happening in our police station. Now, the first and foremost serious attempt to bring the victim into picture and to improve the health of the criminal justice system was made by Justice Malimath Committee, which in its report suggested that it is the time to bring the victim in the forefront. Certain amendments were suggested. The report, which was submitted in 2003, remained gathering dust in the archives of law department for almost 5 years. It was in 2008 that the first amendment was brought, and thereafter a second amendment, Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013, redefining certain rights of the victim. And the most important provision which has been introduced in the Criminal Procedure Code, it's section 357A, which stipulates about an existing victim compensation scheme and says that every state government in coordination with the central government is required to prepare a scheme for providing funds for the purpose of compensation to the victim or his dependent. This legislative provision remained on the pages of law books for couple of years because funds were not available. Ultimately, a scheme was prepared, and this scheme provides that if the trial ends in acquittal or discharge of the victim who has to be rehabilitated, the court will make a recommendation for compensation to the district legal services authority or the state legal services authority, as the case may be, and they will decide the quantum of compensation to be awarded. And if it is a case where the offender could not be traced or identified, and where no trial takes place, the victim or his dependents may make an application to the state or district legal services authority for award of compensation. And such authority is required to decide the application within 2 months. Another important right that has been conferred on the victim is right to appeal by way of proviso to section 372 of Code of Criminal Procedure. It says that the victim can challenge the decision of the trial court in appeal in 3 situations. Firstly, in case of acquittal. Secondly, in case of conviction for lesser offense, suppose the accused was convicted for robbery instead of dacoity. And thirdly, inadequate compensation. So we can see that if a flea bite sentence has been imposed by the court, which is not uncommon, then victim has no right to say that this sentence is almost needy. Now, another thing which we find is the witness protection scheme. In that regard, we find section 195A CRPC, which enables the victim or the witness to file a complaint, and section 195A of IPC, which says that threatening or inducing a person to give false evidence is punishable with imprisonment up to 7 years, or with fine, or with both. Now, there are few other changes, and one very important change is with regard to the rape victims. Their statements have to be recorded in presence of family member, particularly mother, sister, etc., at their home. And the trial has to be conducted in camera by, as far as practicable, a woman judge or a magistrate. Now, these are the legislative initiatives. As regards judicial initiatives, almost 25 years back in 1997, the apex court of our country ordained that a closer report by the prosecution cannot be accepted by the court without hearing the informant. Thereafter, the procedure was adopted to issue notice to the complainant or the victim as what he has to say on the closer report. Then Second thing, it was ordained that victim has a say in the grant of bail to an accused. In the case of Puran Singh versus Ram Vilas, 2001, the Supreme Court said that Section 439(2) of Code of Criminal Procedure recognizes the right of the complainant or any aggrieved party to move the High Court or the Court of Sessions for cancellation of a bail granted to the accused. Then, as was referred by Dr. A.V. Narasimha Rao, it was in the case of Rudal Shah versus the State of Bihar, 1983 Supreme Court, in which the Supreme Court directed the state to pay compensation for abuse of state power. It was a case of illegal incarceration of the victim for long years, and the Supreme Court ordered the government to pay to Rudal Shah ₹30,000 as compensation for abuse of power by the state machinery. The question arises whether all these piecemeal measures can really provide some sort of comfort or solace to the victim who has really never been in the center of the criminal justice system. Indeed, we need a comprehensive legislation in conformity with the United Nations Declaration of 1985. And the report submitted in 1996 by the committee headed by Honorable Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer can be of much help in that regard. There are certain quarters from which a voice is raised that never to compromise with the rights of the accused because he is throughout entitled to fair trial. None can dispute it, of course. But then providing certain relief to the victim simply to enable him to know that what is going on in the case, how he has to be compensated, how he has to be rehabilitated, nowhere is in conflict with the rights of the victim. And it has well been done in countries like United Kingdom and United States of America. So, it is for the legal community, including the academies, the jurists, the lawyers, to raise a voice in the manner it was raised in the United States of America by observing a week for the victims in the countries of European communities where they every year observe a day for the victims. And therefore, it is necessary, rather it is the proper time when we raise the voice, we will help in improving the health of the criminal justice system. Because unless the victim becomes interested, unless he feels that the law machinery is there to protect him, not only from the effects of the crime, but from the further threats, then definitely he will associate himself with the criminal justice delivery system in a magnificent manner, which will help the courts and the system itself. Friends, this is something to ponder over for all of you, because we have to be always vigilant to improve the health of the criminal justice system. And excesses of victims in criminal justice system emerging trends will definitely provide us food for further consideration and thinking to go in the desired direction. So this is something I wanted to share with all of you. If there is any question, there is any query, of course, I am very much available and will be really happy to answer it.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, your lecture was a gem of a lecture, and all the experience, your personal experiences you have put, and it was a great analysis of victimology and how the legislations in India, they need to be changed and they need to be brought in line with the United Nations Declaration of Basic Principles of Crime and Abuse of Power. Thank you so much, sir. It was very informative, and we have got a lot of positive response from the participants. They have said that a lot of people have said that it is a very, very informative lecture, and they would like to have the PPTs that you have shared.
Yes, yes. I will send it.
Thank you so much, sir. We are very thankful for you. We are very thankful that you have taken out time to join it. And now I would like to call upon Professor S.P. Srivastava, who is professor at the National Judicial Academy of India. Sir has also served as the registrar of the National Judicial Academy, and he has had a long and distinguished career in the UP Judicial Services, and he retired as District Judge of Allahabad. He is known for his intellect and endearing personality. And thank you so much for joining us, sir. You're welcome, sir.
Thank you, Professor A.V. Narasimha Rao Garu, Mr. Sharma, and organizers. Thank you very much for inviting me in this webinar. It's very heartening and very good to see that at least some organizations, some academies are organizing programs for the criminal law. Otherwise, most of the universities, they are happy with organizing IPR sessions, cybercrime, etc. Actually, victims and criminals, they have been forgotten nowadays. It is very good. It's at least some universities, some institutions, they are organizing programs for crime, criminals, and criminal law. Because criminal law is now taking a back seat. Nobody is concerned. We are not concerned. We are concerned with the right of intellectual property rights, cyber crime, etc. So today, we will discuss about the victim, and fair trial is the subject, my subject, my topic. So I will try to analyze how this concept of fair trial is developing in India. What has been the treatment given to it by the Supreme Court at various stages? And then I will try to analyze the things, see how the cases, these developments are being reflected. So first we will try to discuss development of fair trial. Then my concern will be how victims' concerns have been adjusted.
There is no response from you.
Am I audible?
Sir, you are audible, sir. Sir, you are audible. Please unmute yourself now.
Again?
Yes.
Fine.
Unmuted, sir.
So, I will focus on the development of the concept of fair trial, how it has been given the status of a fundamental right under Article 21 of the Constitution, and then how the concerns of victim have been accommodated within the concept of fair trial. The victim's concerns is now a part of the fair trial. This is very important and unique development. So I will then try to discuss that concept, and then how in various cases these developments have been applied by the Supreme Court of India. And now I am going to start my slideshow. So fair trial, victim's perspective. Mainly I will try to discuss the victim's perspective, but before coming to that victim's perspective, I will discuss general development of the concept of fair trial. First phase, actually, we all remember we adopted our constitution in the year 1950, And at that time, Article 21 was interpreted a bit differently. We deliberately did not incorporate the concept of due process of law. We all know, as a student of law, at that time there was a huge argument in the Constituent Assembly that we should have the same system as the Americans have, that is, due process of law should be incorporated in the Indian constitutional jurisprudence. But our constitution maker deliberately decided that we will not have due process of law. Instead, under Article 21, we adopted the phraseology procedure established by law. That means they deliberately avoided the technicalities and complexities of the due process, and they said, if we have a procedure that has been enacted by the parliament, the procedure which has the sanction of the parliament, that procedure should be followed, and that if the procedure is followed, then it will be sufficient compliance with the requirement of the constitution. So at that time, much was not available with the judiciary. So what the judiciary did at that time, in the first phase, this phase we can describe as the A.K. Gopalan, Menaka Gandhi stage, they interpreted constitutional laws of the CRPC very technically, hyper-technically, and they tried to give the relief mainly to the accused. At this time, they thought the fair trial is something which is for the accused only. And they said he actually accused this at the trial. Accused is facing trial. Victim is not facing trial. So victim has no place in the fair trial. Fair trial is for the accused because he is charged. He is facing the trial. And there is an accusation, there is a charge against the accused. Therefore, his rights, accused rights, must be protected. So at that time, because we had the procedure, we did not have, we had the procedure established by law. So the Supreme Court did not have much scope to interfere with the procedure as prescribed by the parliament. So what they did, I think my PPT is visible.
Sir, please maximize the PPT tab. It is minimized by mistake.
Okay. Is it now visible?
No, sir. As of now, no.
No.
Maybe you can try resharing it, sir.
Sorry.
No problem, sir. Just like if we minimize the tab, then it shows a black screen. So basically, we don't have to minimize it. Please click on share content, sir, and then select the PPT specifically.
Now I was discussing. Yeah. So first stage, because we had under Article 21 procedure established by law, and the Supreme Court had interpreted it, the procedure established by law means whatever procedure has been prescribed by the parliament, that will be final and that has to be complied with. With this situation, the Supreme Court started to give a very hyper-technical approach. They adopted very hyper-technical approach to protect the right of accused person. At that time, there was no arguments were ever raised. He actually victim has some right in the fair trial. So, at that time, they looked at the things very, very technically. If there was any defect in the investigation, if there was any defect in the method of proof, then the benefit was given to accused. At this stage, primacy to the accused right was given, and presumption of innocence was given full play. If there was any shortcoming, then the benefit was always given to the accused. They literally followed let hundreds of criminals go unpunished, but no innocent person should be punished by the court. And if there was any defect in the investigation, again the benefit was given to the accused without questioning the right of, without questioning the working of the police officers. For example, if there is a murder case and arm is not sent to the ballistic expert, then the benefit is given to the accused. And no question was asked to the police why this has not been done. Nowadays, opposed have changed a lot. If there is any shortcoming in the investigation, immediately show cause notices are issued by the court. An investigator is called upon to explain the conduct. Sometimes disciplinary action is also proposed by the court and it is taken against the wrongdoers. But at that time, these things were very, very exceptional. Mostly, if any shortcoming was found in the investigation or in the proof, then the benefit was given to the accused. And emphasis was the law as such should be complied with strictly. Whatever law is provided, whatever procedure is given, it should be complied with strictly. The second stage after Manika Gandhi case. Manika Gandhi first time ruled that any procedure will not be sufficient. The procedure must be just, fair and reasonable. We all know this thing. And this was a path-breaking judgment. And in fact, what happened, if we imported concept of due process through backdoor. Literally speaking, under Article 21, still we have procedure established by law. But Manika Gandhi says any procedure will not be sufficient. The procedure has to be fair, just, and reasonable. So extending this right, in the Manika Gandhi itself, the Supreme Court pointed out, if the accused is not represented by a competent lawyer, then this procedure cannot be termed as a reasonable procedure. Simply because you say you are entitled to have a lawyer, that will not suffice the requirement of law. So, after Manika Gandhi, a qualitative development took place as far as the right of accused is concerned. The Supreme Court, first of all, they say the right of to consult a counsel and to have a legal representation to advocate is very important. Our criminal system is very technical, and unless accused is represented to a counsel, no justice can be given to the accused. So they insisted that there should be legal services in all respect, and accused should be able to get the legal services when he is facing that trial. And in this process, judiciary tried to fill up the gaps, whatever it was there in the procedure. The first thing they said in the very way back in the year 1979 or 80, in Hussain Ara Khatun case, very important case, all of you must be aware, Hussain Ara Khatun case. In this case, the Supreme Court said, in this case, actually, there were a number of prisoners who were in the jail, and they were in jail in bailable offense. But they never knew that they are in the jail in bailable cases, and they can apply for the bail. So in this case, Supreme Court pointed out that there should be advocates should be provided to the accused person, and if they are not provided advocate, then this is denial of fair trial to the accused persons. In fact, they said very important development at this stage in the Hussain Ara Khatun case. They said that if an accused is produced before the magistrate, or if the accused is produced before a session judge, it is responsibility of the magistrate or the judge to inform that you are entitled to the services of a counsel. You are entitled to the services of an advocate. Very important departure. So far they said, if an accused will demand, I will give the legal assistance. But if the accused is not demanding, we are under no obligation to provide legal assistance to the accused. And here, the Supreme Court took assistance from the very famous case, Miranda versus Arizona, decided by the Americans. In America, I'm just devoting some time here because this is very important development. And we all must know before I go to the written perspective. The Supreme Court took help from the Miranda versus Arizona. In America, we know earlier before 1966, if during interrogation something is said by the accused, the same thing could be used by the prosecution during the trial against the accused. This is not so in the India. In India, we have Section 25-24 in the Indian Evidence Act. We have Section 164 of the Criminal Procedure Code. We have Section 162 of the Criminal Procedure Code. They very well protect the interest of accused. And if the accused is making any statement or making confession, immediately is demanded, you are not bound to make the confession. And whatever you will say, it can be used against you during the trial. But similar provision was not available in America. In America, any statement by the accused during custodial interrogation could be used by the prosecution during trial. So in Miranda versus Arizona for the first time, American Supreme Court said, if the police is conducting custodial interrogation, police is under an obligation to inform the accused that he is entitled to have a lawyer with him, and if he is not able to arrange a lawyer, the police will arrange a lawyer for him even during custodial interrogation. Very important development as far as the American criminal jurisprudence is concerned. And they said unless prosecution is able to prove that this formality, this legal formality was complied with by the prosecution, no statement made by the accused person during police interrogation will be used. So taking help from this development in America, in India also, Supreme Court assumed in Hussain Ara Khatun's case that if the accused is in jail, or if the accused is produced before the magistrate for the first time, even at that stage, magistrate is under an obligation to inform the accused that he is entitled to legal services. And if he is not able to engage a counsel or engage a lawyer because of the poverty or some other reason, then the court is under an obligation to give legal assistance to the accused person. So this development, mere availability of the right is not mere assistance of lawyer is not sufficient. Mere right is not sufficient, but somebody should inform the accused that he is entitled, and if he is not able to arrange a lawyer, if he is not able to get the legal services, then it should be arranged by the court. So this is qualitative development as far as the fair trial is concerned. So far, fair trial was just compliance with the procedure of law. Whatever is prescribed in the CRPC, it should be complied. But here the Supreme Court said there should be information to the accused, and the accused should be in a position to take the legal services, taking help from this. And legal services and legal and the quality also focused on the quality of the legal aid given to the accused. If the legal aid given to the accused is not of adequate quality or good quality, then it was not considered as sufficient compliance with the provision. So far, we have discussed how this concept of a fair trial have been developed as far as the accused is concerned. In Jahira said, for the first time, very loudly and very vocally, the Supreme Court said he not accused alone is entitled to fair trial. Fair trial and everything in the name of fair trial is not for the accused. So accused is all right, entitled for fair trial, but victim and the society interest, societal interest is also important, and victim has something to be offered in the name of fair trial. And they say if the witnesses are being harassed, if the witnesses are not able to depose freely and fairly, this is again a denial of fair trial. When the investigating agency is helping the accused person, when the witnesses are threatened to depose falsely, and prosecutor act in a manner as if he was defending the accused, and the court was acting merely as an onlooker, then there is no fair trial at all. Justice becomes the victim. So here we can see a very important development. Fair trial, as far as accused is concerned, was given a constitutional status under Article 21. In Jaira Habibullah Sheikh and in other cases, they said the right of victim is also part of the fair trial, and they also enjoy the right to fair trial under Article 21 of the Constitution. So please, whatever please. Right is available for the victim in the under the concept of fair trial, it has got the constitutional protection and constitutional status. So this development to my mind is very important, and for the first time, right of victim in the name of fair trial was protected by the Supreme Court, and it was given status of fundamental right under Article 21 of the Constitution. Now we will just pause here and now try to see what exactly fair trial means. After discussing everything, fair trial, how it started, what was its earlier shape, then how the Supreme Court tried to develop it, and how the interest of victim has been accommodated in this concept. Now we will discuss what is the concept of fair trial, and then we will try to discuss how this concept has been applied by the Supreme Court in various
cases. I have one question. Will you please answer it?
Anybody?
Dear participants, we will take all the questions at the end of the session, so please do not interfere in between. Sorry for the interference, sir.
Okay, please. No problem. So, fair trial, if you consider this something that only belongs to the accused, then the only purpose of trial is to find out whether the guilt has been proved beyond all reasonable doubt or not. But if you extend the meaning of fair trial, an interest of victim has also to be seen, and interest of society has also to be seen, then the aim of fair trial becomes ascertaining the truth, not only deciding whether the accused is guilty or not. If the purpose of the function of the court is ascertaining the truth, and not only deciding whether the accused has been, whether the prosecution has been able to prove the guilt, then very focus changes. If you are proceeding from the angle the only accused has every right under the fair trial, then we will not spare any thought for the accused. Suppose if the victim is not able to depose freely and fairly, they say this is the problem of the administration and the prosecution. Prosecution will take care of it. Court is not concerned with it. Court will act as an umpire. But Supreme Court said no. Fair trial is not very limited. As for the accused only, the society, interest of the society is also to be seen. The interest of the victim is also to be seen. The interest of witness is also to be seen. And the purpose of trial is to ascertain the truth. If the purpose of trial is to ascertain the truth, then the entire approach changes. For example, if the witness is not able to give proper answers to the questions, or if the defense counsel is trying to intimidate the witness, then an umpire or neutral umpire would just keep on sitting. But judge is not expected in the present scenario to sit as a mute spectator. The judge is expected to put certain questions to the witness so that the real question is explained to the witness and he is able to give correct answer, rational answer to the questions put by the defense counsel. Here we are not doing something extra, but we are helping the witness and helping the witness not to support the prosecution, but we are helping the witness just to ensure that he is able to depose before the court properly and adequately. If the advocate is confusing, or if he is being threatened, or if he is not able to understand and he is giving some confusing answer, then court has a duty to protect the witness and to ensure that the witness is able to depose freely and fairly. Here the concern is not whether he will support the prosecution or not. No, this is not my concern. My concern is, in the fair trial, my concern is he must be able to understand the question. He should be in a position to depose little freely and fairly, and he should be in a position.
So everybody has answer.
The second aspect
thank
is
thank you for the session.
The second aspect is the fair trial. Again, the Supreme Court in a number of judgments decided the ultimate objective of the fair trial is the protection of human rights. Presumption of innocence is a human right, but protection of victim is also part of the human right. As far as the definition is concerned, we cannot give any accurate, exact definition of the fair trial. So many things are there, and interaction of all these things, they constitute a fair trial. And we may not be in a position to give a exhaustive definition, but we are certainly in a position from the observation in the court whether the fair trial is going on or not. One example I have given, if the witness is being threatened, he is intimidated by the opposite party counsel, then certainly we can say here fair trial is not going on in the court. So ultimate analysis, access to justice and fair trial, these are the core concepts. Rule of law, due process and human rights, they are interconnected. We cannot conceive of a rule of law unless there is access to justice. We cannot conceive due process in the society unless there is access to justice and fair trial. And if these two things are available, then certainly the human right will be protected of each and every person. So in this respect, if we examine the things, three components of stakeholders.
Everyone together. So this is, you know, this is a benefit.
Should I? Okay. So fair trial, there are three stakeholders. Number one is the accused, no doubt. He is the person against whom charges have been framed. No doubt he is a person against whom the prosecution is launched and he is being prosecuted. Therefore, he is entitled to the fair trial. But he is not the only person in this entire scenario to be entitled to the fair trial. Victim or their family members and their relatives, they are also very much entitled to get a fair trial. And the right to fair trial can be denied in a number of ways. If the accused is intimidating, if he is being allured, if he is being, his family members are being threatened, in all these situations, not only offense is being committed against the witnesses, but in fact, his or her right to fair trial under Article 21 is also being violated. And the third most important stakeholder is the society. Society's interest should not be treated with disdain. Society's interest is not persona non grata. Because sometimes what happens, the accused and the victim, they collide with each other. And they try to get a compromise, even in non-compoundable cases. Here, if they are allowed to compromise, or they subvert the prosecution, then who will be the sufferer? Sufferer will be the society, which is the most important stakeholder in the fair trial. I remember one case when I was posted in a district. A lady accused was husband of the lady, and accused tried to cut the neck of the wife, and wife was the victim. Hello, wife was the witness, and when examination started in the courtroom. So then all of a sudden, the wife started saying, you know, I could not see the person, could not see the assailant, and somebody came, he cut my throat. She was safe. He cut my throat and I could not identify the accused person. So actually, there was a compromise between the husband and the wife, and they wanted to have the case settled in this way. But this was a very serious case. of others under section 307, which is not compoundable. How I could permit them to compound a case which is not compoundable and which is so serious? If such type of cases are allowed to be compromised, then who is going to suffer? Society is going to suffer, and majesty of law will not be there. So in similar situation come before the judges in every day. So many cases come before the judges. They find the accused was accused and victim. They compromise the cases in non-compoundable offenses. And in such situation, if these cases are allowed to be compromised, then society will be the sufferer, because law and order and harmony in the society cannot be maintained unless the accused are punished and a lesson is given to the other persons, like-minded persons. If you will commit serious offenses, serious crime, then you will be punished, no matter whether the victim is supporting you or not supporting you. So these three angles are there, these three stakeholders are there, and interest of each one of these stakeholders are protected under the concept of fair trial. So now we can very safely say it is not only the accused, but victim also, and the society at large also, whose interest is protected under the concept of fair trial. Now, few words about the fair trial. What exactly it should be? These are the important attributes of the fair trial. Judge should be impartial, but at the same time, the judge should not be mute spectator. Very important development. Now, almost all the cases the Supreme Court is saying, a mute spectator judge, a recording machine, is not needed. Judge should be active participant in the trial. If something wrong is going on in the trial, then judge has to interfere. If the witness is being intimidated, judge has to interfere. If the accused is not given the right to fair kind of trial, judge has to interfere. And wide power is given to the judge under section 165 of the Indian Evidence Act. This section says, at any stage of the trial, judge can put any question, whether it is relevant or irrelevant to anybody, whether he is witness or the accused or the victim, and can elicit the answer. Purpose is to elicit the truth. Purpose is not only to find out whether the case is proved or not, or even if the prosecutor is trying to support the accused, judge should not be helpless. Judge should be in a position to put questions and put the things in right perspective. So when I say or we say there should be an impartial judge, yes, judge should be impartial. Judge has no witness to support the prosecution. Judge has no witness to support the accused. But judge has every witness to find out the truth of the matter. And if somebody is trying to hide the truth, judge can always interfere and try to find out what is the truth in the matter. And then second component is the fair prosecutor. No doubt judge should be transparent and fair. The prosecutor should also be fair. In fact, in a number of cases, now they are saying if the prosecutor is not properly functioning, then victim can also engage his own counsel, so that the prosecutor is not in it, gets the free hand to subvert the case of prosecution. This is a new development. Earlier, this was not possible. Atmosphere of judicial calm. This is something which is important, but unfortunately, this is not happening in most of the trial courts. If you go to any trial court, you will find there is like a Machli Bazaar fish market. So many persons are there, each one of them is talking to each one, other person, clerk is talking to the clerk is talking to the accused, the accused is talking to the lawyer, and judicial calm is not there. The Supreme Court has emphasized that there should be judicial calm in the courtroom. If the judicial calm is not available, then certainly there cannot be a fair trial in that court. And there should be elimination of bias. Bias against or for against the accused, very important. In Kasab's case, we all know Kasab was a Pakistani national. he was being prosecuted. And all of you must be knowing, he confessed before the magistrate. But the judge said, no, I will not act on your confession. We will go for a trial. Because the judge wanted to show to the entire world, there is no bias against the accused. Simply because he is accepting the guilt, we are not going to punish him. I need witnesses. If the witnesses will support, if the prosecution is in a position to prove the case, then alone we will punish the accused. So there should be no bias against the accused, no bias against the witnesses. Sometimes some judges, some prosecutors, they just have some bias against the witnesses. Oh, this person belongs to such and such caste, so he will not be able to prove the case. There is bias against the police witness. Generally, they say the police witness will certainly support the prosecution and they should not be relied on. The Supreme Court says no, there should be no bias. And each witness should be judged on the strength of the deposition made by the witness in the court. And again, there should be no bias against the cause. So these biases should be eliminated, then alone we can ensure fair trial in courts. Freedom from false evidence and witness intimidation. Very, very important. To build up a false case, sometimes pocket witnesses are produced before the court, and witnesses and some truth, if the truthful witnesses come, they are intimidated or they are given allurements and they are bribed and they are in fact made to report falsely before the court. The court is under their responsibility to see that witnesses are not intimidated. Although it's a very good problem, witness in the courtroom, we can protect the witness, but outside the courtroom, what is happening, courts have no control, so witness protection and other things has to be there. But important thing is that if this concept, the witness should be protected, has been given a place in the fair trial. This is very important. Somehow or other, now this has become a fundamental right under the Constitution. All the material witnesses should be heard by the court. Court should not deny to hear material witnesses, whether it is accused, whether it is prosecution witness, whether it is accused witness, if it is a material witness, it should be examined by the court. Judicial evaluation of the totality of the evidence, oral and circumstances, and not in isolation. Very important, again, a concept. A fair trial is not possible unless holistic view is taken. What happens sometimes, one sentence in the deposition, they pick up the one sentence and start trying to know this witness is a liar, this witness is not a liar. No, the deposition should be evaluated in the entirety. Entire statement should be read, and then an impression should be gathered whether this witness is a truthful witness or not. So these are all the attributes of fair trial. And if these things are available, then alone we can say the fair trial is going on. And witness, if the interest of victim and interest of society is also protected. As far as the role of judge is concerned, I have already discussed this point. The Supreme Court is saying he should be a participant in the trial, evincing intelligence, active interest, and elicit all relevant materials necessary for reaching the correct conclusion, and ceases to be a spectator and mere recording. Very important judgment, Jaira Habibullah, Jaira Sheikh's case, and subsequent all the cases, they are saying the judge, unfortunately, this happens. When the deposition starts, judge starts doing some other work, and deposition is going. This is very, very fatal part of the trial. Judge should, when the trial is going on, when the deposition is taking place, just to stop doing any other one. And he should focus on the deposition itself and the conduct of the trial. So far this was not being given much importance, but now the Supreme Court saying the role of judge is very important to secure fair trial. Same way, if the fair hearing is not given to the accused or the prosecution, then the due process of law is violated. It is inherent in the concept of due process of law that condemnation should be rendered only after the trial in which the hearing is a real one. not shame or mere farce and pretense. Hearing should be real hearing. The trial is a very serious matter and it should be conducted very seriously. Haphazard way, trial in a haphazard way, in piecemeal, this is no trial at all as far as the fair trial is concerned. So they have cautioned the judges, when trial is going on, they should, all their attention should be on the trial. And as I have pointed out, it is a search of truth. Trial is search for truth and it is not a bout over technicalities. You just hang on some technical issue and start subverting everything. Technicalities, all right. If there is a prejudice to the accused person, certainly he is entitled to the benefit of doubt. But really there are some technical defects. For example, something which the investigator should have done, but he has not done. Then the question is whether some prejudice has been caused to the accused person or not. If the prejudice has been caused, he will get the benefit. If there is no prejudice, only on the technical ground, acquittal cannot be recorded. So trial has to be done in a holistic way and it cannot depend upon some technical defect in the case. So this is a complete departure from the earlier approach. In earlier, criminal trial was very technical approach. They will just say, sir, this witness was not examined, this sentence was not put to the witness, and this formality was not done by the investigator or the prosecutor, and I am entitled. They said, if one mistake could be found, that was sufficient to get the acquittal. But now this is not possible. Now, they say everything in the totality. And if there is some real prejudice to the accused person, he will get the benefit, otherwise not. So it is not a technical business. Not only a technical business. Holistic has to be there. Must be under the such rule as will protect the innocent and punish the guilty. So it is equally important that innocent should be protected, but it is also important that guilty should be punished on the basis of hostility of the witness, on the basis of defect in the investigation, on the basis of incompetence of the prosecutor. On these basis alone, acquittal order should not be passed. Because if we will do like that, then who will suffer? Ultimately, the society will suffer. In many cases, as I have pointed out, if both the parties, they come together and they try to compromise in serious cases. But here, the role of judge becomes very important. Because interest of society, stake of society is there. And the stake of society, interest of society is, if there is a criminal, he must be punished. And with the help of technicality, he should not be able to get rid of the punishment. Fair trial may be vitiated and violated by an over-stage manner, tailored and partisan trial. The fair trial for a criminal offense consists not only in technical observance of the frame and forms of the law, but also in cognition and just application of its principles and substance to find out the truth and prevent the miscarriage of justice. Speed of the trial nowadays, the courts are emphasizing the criminal cases should be disposed of very quickly, and because this directions from the higher courts. In some cases, the criminal trials is being completed in a week or in 15 days or in a month. Supreme Court is now saying, no doubt, a speedy trial is a good thing and it should be welcome. But hasty trial, in which the accused is not able to protect his interest, in which the accused is not able to properly cross-examine the witnesses, and accused is not able to defend himself properly, such kind of trial should be discouraged. Speedy trial is good, but in reaching that result, the accused charged with a serious business must not be stripped of his valuable right of a fair and impartial trial. Assistance of counsel, I have discussed this concept in detail. Earlier, there was a thinking leave only at the time of trial, accused is entitled to counsel. But after Hussain Ara Khatun case, it has been very clearly established now that even at the pre-trial presentation before the court, the accused is entitled to the help of counsel. And magistrate and the judge is under an obligation to inform the accused person that you are entitled to legal assistance, and if you are not able to get engage a counsel, then the court will arrange the counsel. As far as the presence of counsel at the stage of investigation is concerned, the opinion is divided. In Nandini Satpathy case, the Supreme Court directed if the counsel is not provided at the stage of investigation or custodial interrogation, that is denial of Article 21. But in subsequent cases, the Supreme Court is saying, you know, in all each and every cases, it is not possible to give legal assistance at the stage of custodial interrogation by the police. So at this stage is still not very clear, but as far as the pre-trial stage is concerned, whenever the accused is produced before the magistrate, he is entitled to legal assistance. As far as the legal assistance is concerned, quality of legal assistance is very important. Muhammad Hussain, this is a very important case. He was a Pakistani terrorist, Muhammad Hussain, and trial was going on. Though this case is in favor of the accused person, and retrial has been ordered by the Supreme Court. But what happened in this case, so many witnesses were examined, and when the witnesses were being examined, no counsel was given, no help of the counsel was given to the accused person. 56 witnesses, including the eyewitnesses and investigating officer, were recorded by the trial court without providing a counsel to the appellant. 8 witnesses were examined in the presence of the freshly appointed permanent counsel who thought fit not to cross-examine. So they said, if you are giving the assistance of a freshly appointed defense counsel, he will not be in a position to cross-examine properly. So quality of the legal assistance is very important. In this case, the Supreme Court quashed the judgment of the conviction and they remanded the case back to the trial court. No doubt again, the trial was conducted and the trial is still going on. But first conviction was set aside by the Supreme Court because the quality of legal assistance provided in this case was deficient. Asha Ranjan is another aspect in which the right of a victim was given predominance over the right of accused person. Actually, this is a very famous case. There was a notorious Shahabuddin, we all know. He was lodged in a Bihar jail, Siwan jail. And in this case, a press reporter was, his 3 sons were murdered, and ultimately he was also murdered. His wife had filed the complaint, and the cases were going on against the accused person. He was in jail, in Siwan jail, district in state of Bihar. But the complainant, victim, said before the Supreme Court, he will remain in the Bihar, even in the jail. He is in a position to defend the witnesses. He is in a position to influence the trial. Therefore, the trial cannot take place in the Siwan. They requested the accused should be transferred in some other case. There is a Prisoners Act. In the Prisoners Act, this case was not covered, and the technically speaking, legally speaking, accused could not be transferred from one state to the other. There is a very famous case, we all know, of the Supreme Court, in which the Supreme Court has said the accused cannot be transferred to another state because that will hamper his right to defense, and he will be denied the company of his friends, his legal assistance and his family members. Therefore, accused cannot be transferred to other state. But in Asha Ranjan, Supreme Court tried to balance the right to fair trial of the victim and right to fair trial of the accused. And they say, in this case, transfer of the accused from Bihar to Delhi is very much required for the fair trial. The Supreme Court said, if this Mr. Shahabuddin will remain in Bihar, fair trial is not possible. Therefore, they said, Shahabuddin should be transferred to Delhi jail and trial will be conducted through video conferencing. So you can see how the concern of victim has been accommodated in the concept of fair trial. Malak Ram versus Estes Uttarakhand. Again, a very technical thing. Here, what happened? We know the case diary cannot be used by the accused person during the trial unless case diary is being used by the witness, prosecution witness, or the court. In this case, the court perused the case diary but did not use the case diary during the trial, and it was returned to the prosecutor. So the situation was the accused was not in a position to use the case diary for the purpose of prosecution. So they tried to subvert the provision. They said they filed some pages of the case diary, certified copies of the case diary, and they requested the court if these pages should be admitted in the evidence. Had these pages were admitted, the accused could put questions with the reference to these pages, and the purpose could be served. Thus, very technical issue. They could not use the case diary. They tried to find out via media. They filed case diary, some pages of the case diary, obtained certified copies of the case diary and filed so that they could use the case diary for the cross-examination of witnesses. The Supreme Court said, no, you cannot subvert the provision of 172 because the case diary was not used by the witness to witness his memory. Therefore, in the name of fair trial, you cannot use case diary in this case. Ajay Singh, very unique kind of judgment. Right of trial, actually after the trial, a judgment was pronounced, you were acquitted, but no formal judgment was passed by the trial. There was an order on the order sheet, you were acquitted, but no formal judgment was passed. The Supreme Court said there was no fair trial. Fair trial means the trial should culminate in a formal judgment which should be signed and pronounced in open court. In this case, no judgment was signed, no judgment was pronounced, only there was an order sheet and which said ki you are acquitted. The Supreme Court said there was no fair trial at all in this case. This is, I'm trying to just explain how the concept of fair trial is being used by the parties and how this is being protected by the Supreme Court in various cases. State versus Bihar Raj Ballabh. Here again, the person was in jail. This was a POXO case and minor girl was raped. The person was in jail for some time and subsequently he was granted bail by the High Court. The bail cancellation was moved in the name. If the accused will remain on bail, then their fair trial cannot take place in the court. The Supreme Court cancelled the bail of the person after holding that in this case, unless the accused is behind the bar, fair trial is not possible. Again, we can see the interest of victim, interest of witness was given predominance over the right of accused to plea and fair trial and right of accused to remain at liberty. Shiv Kumar Yadav, here again, trial was being conducted in the trial court. Witnesses were examined. In the beginning, there was no counsel appointed by the accused person. Subsequently, accused appointed a counsel. He cross-examined certain witnesses. Subsequently, that accused changed his lawyer. The new lawyer said, I want to cross-examine all the witnesses once again. The application was moved. This application was rejected by the trial court. The matter went up to the High Court. High Court allowed the application. The matter went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court said, in the name of fair trial, you cannot call all the witnesses once again in cross-examination. Actually, this practice is being employed in a number of cases by the accused persons to intimidate and to ensure to secure hostility of the witnesses. So if the witness is examined and no new question need to be asked, then generally he should not be re-invited, re-examined by the court. Vinod Kumar, again, the court pointed out what should be the rule. Here in this Vinod Kumar case, it was a case under Prevention of Corruption Act. Witness was examined, some witnesses turned hostile. One witness was supportive of the prosecution case. But after his examination in chief, his cross-examination took place after 20 months. And during this period, he was won over. And when he was examined after 20 months, he turned hostile and did not support the prosecution. So Supreme Court came heavily on the trial court and said, this kind of approach cannot be accepted. The trial judge cannot grant adjournment like this, because if you grant the adjournment like this, you are denying the fair trial to the accused and the prosecution and the witness, more important. Because if you do not complete the cross-examination or the examination of the witness in one go, then a lot of time is available to the accused person to win over the witness. And if the accused is given the opportunity to win over the witness, then certainly this is denial of fair trial as far as the victim is concerned. Similarly, in all these cases, the same thing has been repeated by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is emphasizing the trial should be conducted in a serious manner. It should go in one go. If the witnesses' examination has started, then it should continue one after the another, unless all the witnesses are examined. If this practice is not adopted, then accused get all that opportunity to win over the witness. And if the accused is given the opportunity to win over the witnesses, then certainly it is denial of the fair trial. And the sufferer is the victim, who is also entitled, who is also a stakeholder as far as the fair trial is concerned. So this is how fair trial is being perceived by the Supreme Court and other courts. Supreme Court is saying only accused is not entitled to fair trial, victim is also entitled to fair trial, and the most important stakeholder in the society is large. Society's interest lies in ensuring that criminals are punished, and if there is any denial or if there is any violation of this right of the society, then this is denial of the fair trial. So complete change is there. No doubt, basically and primarily, fair trial is concerned with the right of the accused. Primarily, he is entitled to fair trial, but it is not like only he is entitled to fair trial. There are other stakeholders. Their interest is also protected under the concept of fair trial. And most important to this, if this right is given the status of a constitutional right under Article 21. So this is how perspective of the witness and victim is being addressed to the fair trial concept. So thank you very much for the patient audience. And if there are questions, I'll be happy to.
Thank you so much, sir. Your lecture was very informative, and we have got a lot of positive feedback in the chat box. And we have quite a few questions also. People have asked for your PPTs, and one person has said that your PPTs have got so much of knowledge and they are very well compacted and everything. So it was very nice to have your lecture. We have a few questions, sir, with the permission of director, sir.
Asta, before going to question, let me sum up so that we can complete the questions and then close up. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Professor S.P. Srivatsava and Honorable Justice Mr. Vedaprakash. Mr. Vedaprakash has given a complete picture of criminal justice system, its evolution, and the status of victimology and victim. Also referred to the Malimath Committee. So this is a criminal procedure code amendments, and also other related matters. This is a very really very interesting subject. Now, even though we have a different accepted model to provide the compensation to victim, in practice, it is not being implemented so far. Many people, more particularly, people who have suffered under these what's called sexual assault and so on. So those people, how they are going to get the compensation? Are we valuing the compensation in terms of money? What are the dignity they lost, and what are the tag they carry during entire life after the incident is over? It is very difficult to assess the valuation. Second, suppose a person has expired because of the mishandling of the case, mishandling of the equipment. That particular person may be, that person handling may be the government or government employee, government organization. As a result, the dependents or legal self of that particular person becomes victims. Why they are victims, though they are not involved in the kind of this thing? Because the person who expired is the source of income for them. And that particular person expired and the sources are lost. If the children are very young age, or if they are not employed anywhere, other source of income is not there, then what kind of hard positions they will be experiencing? Entire life throughout their lives, they will have to suffer. Because the value of the person cannot be estimated. That's a well-known fact. In case of Motor Vehicles Act, we have different kinds of multipliers to find out what can be compensation we can give and due to the victims, though we cannot bring back the life of a person. Financially support we are going to give. But in case of other part, in a case of murder by a particular person, what kind of compensation the victim will get, or victim legal heirs or dependents will get? So there's a lot to discuss and a lot to bring onto the slate about this victim compensation part. The compensation what we're giving, only nominal, not equivalent to the loss suffered by that particular person. Even in case of injuries also, you may not be in a position to compensate that particular person in total. We are really there to discuss many, and most important is, as our Honorable Judge said, during the trial of the particular person, a person who is a victim is important, around whom the investigation goes on, around whom the trial goes on, around whom the judgment come. But at the end of the day, he will only be a passive party to the system, to the crime. Unless you make him active, unless let him talk about losses he suffered, unless the court thinks in a different way, not only giving the punishment, maybe a hanging or life imprisonment or otherwise. For those systems, those things, wait. Let us take the Nirbhaya case. Nirbhaya case, in that particular part, the accused were hanged after a long, long time. During this particular period of 5-6 years, the dependents or legal heirs or family members of Nirbhaya, what kind of mental agony they suffered, what kind of trauma they experienced, how the things are they faced, how the society has treated them. All these are the issues we have to think of. So this criminal justice system, though we are having the adversarial system, we may think more than that, how better we can go, we can do the things part of it. So this with this, and I express my sincere thanks to Mr. Srivatsava. He has given a plethora of cases, a number of cases in which the victims have been discussed. And this particular, he has given conceptual understanding of victimology, and also how the victim has to be protected, what are the different roles he has to play, and how can we go, all these issues have been discussed with Srivatsava sir. Thank you very much, Mr. Srivatsava. Thank you very much, Honorable Justice Mr. Vedaprakash, for everything. I express sincere thanks to Justice Prakash Rao and other judges who are present during this particular webinar. I express my sincere thanks to everyone who participated. Now, the formal question answers will be taking place. Thank you very much, Asta. Thank you very much, Mr. Dili, for arranging all these things. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. So, sir, we have a few questions now. So the first question is, to Honorable Justice Sri Ved Prakash Sharma, sir. In the United Kingdom, after the completion of trial, there are provisions of victim impact statement, which would ensure fair compensation to them in terms of physiological trauma suffered during the process of prosecution by the victim and his family. Sir, why do we not have such a provision in our criminal procedure itself? I think sir is not there, so can I ask Professor Srivastava to answer this question? The person is asking about the victim impact statement. Can we have, this is a very novel suggestion and actually being followed in the United Kingdom. So he is asking that if there is a provision for victim impact statement to ensure fair compensation in terms of the harm that is and the trauma that is suffered by the victim, can we have such a provision in our own system?
Certainly, welcome suggestion. It can have, this is our system. But unfortunately, because the infrastructure that we have and the number of cases, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. Number of cases that we have and number of judges that we have. In fact, so far we have not been able to conduct fair trial in the courts. There are so many problems. So, suggestion is very good, but before suggestion is implemented and some provision is made in the CRPC, we should arrange for the infrastructure. There should be backward integration. And if the backward integration is ensured, then certainly we can have this kind of provision in our criminal law.
Let me add to this. Mr. Srivastava, being at National Judicial Academy, this whatever the concept that is now discussed, I would request you to bring to the notice of the judges during your lectures or informal talks.
Yes.
So you are at a crucial place where you can interact with the many judges of Supreme Court and High Court and discuss whatever the things that are coming up in the criminal justice system. First of all, what's a fair trial for the fair compensation for the this particular victim? There's no measurement for the fair trial. It's only abstract thing that we're talking about. How to measure, evaluate the meaning of the fair compensation under a given situation, or whether it is going to compensate the person for the future part of it. When you take this concept of the future protection, how we are going to take the money value in the future. Inflation is there. Whatever, if you are giving 1 lakh today, it may not be sufficient after a few years. We may think 1 lakh is a very great amount. So these questions ought to be decided as a part of policy matters. Because you are at the helm, our Justice Raghuram is also there. He is a very good thinker about all these things. I request you to submit to Justice Raghuram Garu to assess what do you mean by fair concept, fair compensation. And just like in motor vehicles, is there a possibility of creating multiplier to give the compensation to the victim under different situations when that particular victim or the legal heirs of the victim? We are only talking the victim now. We have to talk about the legal heirs of the victim.
Yes.
Victim means legal heir also. We have to think how it has to be compensated. The two things are very important as questioned by one of our participants. We appreciate the questions. Asla, you can go for the next question.
So I am combining three questions actually after this. One, all of them are based on whether there should be a particular timeline in order to make the system work at a proper speed. And the second question which is here is that there is a delay and due to COVID-19, many of the courts have not been working. So all of these three questions are basically talking about delay in the criminal justice system. And would you like to give certain measures from your side in as to how this delay can be avoided or reduced?
Certainly, justice denied is justice denied, but justice hurried is justice buried. So, no doubt, cases should be disposed of with speed. But certainly, the right of accused to defend adequately and properly should be taken care of. And if, because of the hurry, accused is not able to defend properly, then this will be denial of fair trial. And in the Supreme Court, actually, timeline, as far as the timeline is concerned, there was a case decided by the Supreme Court, Rajdev Prasad. In that case, timeline was prescribed. If suppose there is a summons case, it should be disposed of within 2 years. If it is a warrant case, it should be disposed of within 3 years. But it could not work even, because there is a variety of factors and considerations when the trial is going on. Suppose in one particular trial, witness is living somewhere far away. If he comes, the defense counsel is not available. So they thought a timeline cannot be provided. But in each case, suddenly the Supreme Court said, in each case, we can examine whether there is undue delay, so much so that the right of the accused has been denied or not. If the right of accused is jeopardized and there is a prejudice to the right of accused, then certainly the benefit of delay can be given to the accused person. But to be applicable to all cases uniformly, we cannot have a time limit. This is my impression. If we cannot have a time limit, it will create a lot of problems. But in each case, justice should be done as soon as possible, as early as possible. And every stakeholder should try to get it.
May I add something to this?
Yeah, please.
Whatever the timelines, 2 years, 3 years are given for the completing the process and investigation, case trial, not for the payment of victim's compensation.
Victim compensation is another thing.
Yeah, yeah, victim suffers on the day of incident or accident.
Yeah, correct.
Whenever that particular person suffers, if the case is decided after 5 years or 6 years or 10 years, if the particular person, what she or he has to do during the 5 years or 6 years without having, whether she has to go for a begging, whether talk to the victims of conferences, compensation, there should be interim payment immediately after the things are happened without any further wait, whether the case is proved or not. There is a public liability insurance act is there. Like that, there should be some kind of provision which has to help under the National Legal Service Authority or otherwise. Go to that particular victim or let victim apply to the National Legal Service Authority is another case, another mode of the approach for the payment of compensation, so that they can at least sustain day-to-day operational expenditure. If that is not there, till the case is proved, means automatically there will not be existence for the victims also. If a very poor people are there, their problem will be there. For this particular purpose, there is a need. Again, this concept has to be discussed in the judicial academy for this particular purpose.
We certainly, we will discuss that. We are discussing all the judicial academy. And some attempt is being done. For example, if a fire is lodged by a lady, immediately some money is given to that lady so that she is able to sustain herself and she is able to meet the expenses of education. In Uttar Pradesh, the moment a fire is lodged, some compensation is given to the at that time itself. But I think this has to be enlarged and there should be a structure, framework.
Yes, that's what I'm asking also.
Yeah,
unfortunately, the scheme, what you are talking about, the victim compensation scheme, is not prevailing in all the states. Only few states have enacted them.
Why
the government should not ask the state government to frame them? The government should take initiation. It is a kind of a social welfare legislation.
Yeah, correct.
The government should take an initiation, direct all the states to go for victim compensation schemes. And also,
at the disposal of the
need-based payment should be done to the victims. Then we are talking about the victimology, then we are asking, claiming as ourselves as a welfare state. You know, nowadays governments are paying lot of sops to the people. Poor people, the name of the poor people, and different schemes, they are paying money free of cost. Simply, they are transferring to the accounts of the people. What is wrong with the victim?
Certainly, no problem.
He should have been given.
I think if the subcompensation is given at the very beginning, that will give a lot of assurance and relief to the victim. Otherwise, she will be or he will be broken during the process of that. So this is very important. Some step is being taken, but I think much needs to be done in this regard. Yes. And still, I think governments are not very serious about all these things. From all corners, pressure should be exerted, and yes, then along the way.
Next question is, sir, does media trial violate the right to free and just trial?
Certainly, I think if the media trial is going on, it affects the trial. But as judges, we are advised that we should not be influenced by what is going on in the media, and judges should try to rely on the evidence which is produced in the court and which is being evaluated by the judge, but knowingly or unknowingly, because judges are also part of the society, they are audience of all the news items in the media. Therefore, we cannot deny that there will be some impact on the judge. But as far as judges are concerned, we are trained like that. We will not take into account all these things, any of these things, and we try to dispose of cases on the basis of materials which are available before the court during the trial.
Next question.
Thank you so much, sir. We have another question that about plea bargaining system. Can we have such a system in India?
Yeah, we have. We have a provision in CRPC, plea bargaining, and there is a complicated system. When there is an application for plea bargaining, notice is given to the victim, notice is given to the accused. All the three come to the court and they try to bargain the things. This was incorporated on the model of United States, but unfortunately, in India, barring very few states, this system has not been a successful. This has not been a successful system. In most of the cases, instead of going for plea bargaining, what the accused do, they try to influence the witness and try to ensure that witnesses turn hostile, and they try to get the benefit of technicalities and they try to go for the acquittal. But this system is there, elaborate procedure is there. Maybe it needs to be changed because the procedure is very complicated and lengthy. Therefore, many accused persons, they are not taking benefit of this procedure in India, though it is very popular in United States of America.
Sir, we have two questions which are related to the custodial deaths that took place recently in Tamil Nadu. And one person is asking, even after the DK Bose guidelines, why do we have this? Why do we have to witness this thing? And another thing is, could you respond on the Tamil Nadu High Court activism on custodial deaths at the police station and the negligence of police personnel? So, to both the questions combined, please answer them.
Actually, custodial death is the worst thing that can happen to any dignified society. And if in 2020 this kind of thing is happening, that means we have not been able to come out of the mindset that prevailed during our slavery. Still, the police feels we are the kings and we can do whatever we like. Very stern action should be taken against these police persons, and immediate FIR should be lodged. I think there was a judgment in the Hyderabad High Court. It said if there is any death in the encounter death or custodial death, immediate FIR should be lodged. Here in this case, after 24 hours, 48 hours, there was no FIR. And the state thought, if by suspending two police officials, we have done our duty. So this is worst thing that can happen in any situation. And all the courts, they are unanimous. This kind of thing should not happen. And those who are responsible for this kind of thing, they should be very sternly dealt. But I think systems are not very adequate and still political very strict.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir. The next question we have from Jayanta Barua. He is asking, can the state provide for an insurance scheme whereby a person can be insured against offenses like murder and rape, etc.?
I think...
Let me answer this.
Please.
Insurance of a person, already government is having many schemes for poor people, for agriculture labor, and Vajpayee insurance scheme like that. There are many teams. Okay, government if insures a person against the murder, it will becomes a moral hazard. All people try to get that amount. You have been hearing stories, and also we have been seeing many cases that husband and wife or partner or a family member take insurance on other people for sake of taking the amount back. They are killing it. It is not recommended. And also, it is a question of moral hazard. On the part of moral hazard, the insurance company themselves will not have an insurance policy at all to this thing. Please remember. Another important is, victim will be only known or identified with the incident as till incident happens. Nobody can be termed as a victim. Either it may be myself or somebody else. How will we know as a victim? Only incident happens. So if you take the insurance in advance, are we encouraging the people to become a victims? We don't want any victims in the society. Whether it is a Western city, Western society, or Indian society. We don't want any victims. We don't want any accused people. We want all people equal, respecting one another. Thank you very much. Next question.
The next question is about the victim compensation scheme. Can you elaborate on the victim compensation scheme under the CRPC?
At present, it will be difficult to elaborate all those things. 1 minute, sir. It is very difficult because time is already 6:20. You may send a mail to Mr. Saxena, Srivatsava. He'll be answering you, giving the details.
Okay, sir. So I think
you may close the questions now because already 6:20.
Thank you so much, sir.
And what are the questions left? Please answer by mails.
Yes, sir. Definitely, we'll be answering the questions by sending the mails. And if you permit, I would like to propose a vote of thanks.
Yes, sure.
So we would like to thank our guests, Honorable Mr. Justice Ved Prakash Sharma, sir, and Professor S.P. Srivastava, for taking out time from their busy schedules and joining us today. Your lectures will definitely spark further debate and broaden the discourse on the position of victim in the criminal justice system in India, sir. We would also like to thank Dr. A.V. Narasimha Rao, and he has been a guiding light at every step of the way. I and Mr. Dilip would also like to thank Murli sir for providing all the technical support that we needed. And we express our gratitude towards all the faculty and students who have joined us today in this webinar and made it a great success. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank
you so much, sir. Thank you for joining us. Thank you. I would also like to thank Hemlata ma'am and Honorable Mr. Justice Prakash Rao, sir, for joining us today. Thank you so much, ma'am. Your presence has been a great morale booster for us.
Thank you. Thank you, Asta, and congratulations for the successful conduct.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. So, thank you, sir, director, so for arranging this very, very important discussion on this very important topic, sir. Thank you very much, sir.